department is our dean's representative, and she's here to make sure that we're fair to Maggie and vice versa. So I guess she's, if you have complaints, please see Karen. Rich Walker, who is a professor in geology, also the chair of the geology department, and Kieran Howard, who is our outside member from the City University of New York, Kingsborough College, and the American Museum of Natural History. And Kieran has been part of this project actually slightly longer than Maggie. So happy to have everybody here. And now for the formalities. I think it is our tradition that everybody rise at this point, please. Honorable candidate, you see before you a committee from the graduate faculty appointed by the graduate school of this university to investigate whether you are worthy of a degree of Doctor of Philosophy in Astronomy. The committee has considered the progress of your graduate studies and has read your thesis, or at least we said. You are now given a final opportunity to provide an oral proof of your abilities as a scientist and a scholar. In order to assist the committee with its evaluation, we request that you commence this examination with a 30-minute or less summary of the subject discussed in your thesis.
All right. Thank you, everybody, for coming. I'm really excited to see y'all here today. Okay, so I wanted to begin by taking a quick look at the sort of Astronomy 101 version of the solar system, and that is that the inner solar system is characterized by rocky materials, such as the terrestrial planets and asteroids, and the outer solar system is characterized by icy materials, like comets. The two regions of the solar system are delineated by the snow line, which is the region in the disk where the temperature is cool enough for water ice to be stable. Interior to the snow line, it's too hot and water would be vapor. So it's somewhat surprising then that we have observations from both in meteorites and on asteroids that we see water ice and evidence for water in the form of hydrated minerals. So hydrated minerals were formed on asteroids and in meteorites through a process called aqueous alteration. Aqueous alteration is the chemical reaction between liquid water and silicate rock that produces these hydrated minerals. The water that reacts with these materials is co-accreted with the rest of the body during the asteroid's accretion. So it's clear that, is it gonna break already? So it's clear that water ice was a significant component of the early solar nebula in the region where asteroids were forming. But what we don't really understand yet is the distribution, abundance, and timing of when this water was available for accretion. So I wanted to start to investigate this question, trying to understand the distribution of water ice in the disk, particularly in the region where asteroids were forming, and when it was available for accretion. And the way that I'm doing that is by connecting in-situ studies of meteorites and to asteroids using a tool called spectroscopy. So spectroscopy is the study of how matter interacts with light. And because minerals that make up rocks have particular lattice structures, we can probe them and we can understand what an asteroid and meteorite is made out of remotely. So this is a way that we can study asteroids and understand the water in them. So I just wanted to briefly describe some of the evidence that we have for water on asteroids and hydrated minerals. So again, these materials, hydrated minerals, are produced during aqueous alteration, which occurs on the parent asteroid soon after it accreted. The first region that we can use to identify hydrated minerals is the 0.7 micron feature. So this is in the visible. And here I'm showing two plots. The x-axis for most of the plots in this presentation is wavelength, because we're looking at spectroscopy. And the y-axis is reflectance in this case. So here, what's boxed up is the 0.7 micron feature. So this is caused by a charge transfer between two iron atoms in a hydrated mineral structure. So the photons it absorbs are at 0.7 microns, so the presence of this feature indicates the presence of hydrated minerals. The first 0.7 micron features observed on asteroids was done by Bylus and Gaffey in 1989. That was some of the first work. The other region we can look at is the 3-micron region. So here, again, we have a feature. It's this check mark shape in the spectrum. That is caused by the fundamental vibration of hydroxyl in the hydrated mineral structure. So again, we're probing the structure of these materials, and the presence of this check mark shape indicates the presence of hydrated minerals on this asteroid. In addition, we have evidence for water ice. So this is, here we're showing the rounded feature here. It's different than the checkmark shape from above. And so this indicates the presence of water ice on the surface of this asteroid. So these two spectra are from Tahir and Emery in 2012. They did a large survey of main belt objects, and they were trying to understand the relationship between checkmark and rounded features and heliocentric distance. They also identified two other groups of 3-micron morphologies, but most of their observations were either checkmark or rounded features. So they took their 3-micron morphology, which here they're representing by the symbol. So the red check marks are the hydrated mineral asteroids, and the green circles are the rounded water ice rich asteroids. And they're overplotting them on a contour plot of temperature from Grimm and McSween in 1993. So what Grimm and McSween were doing was trying to understand the zoning in the main asteroid belt caused by the heat being from aluminum 26. So they took, they assumed a particular amount of aluminum 26 that was present when these asteroids accreted, and they also assumed some amount of water ice in the disk after 2.7 AU. So here again we have, this now is the heliocentric distance and astronomical units on the x-axis, and diameter of the asteroid on the y-axis. So the contour plots describe the peak temperature that the asteroid experienced based on the heating from aluminum 26, which is the main heat source in the early solar system. In the inner part of the solar, the asteroid belt, the peak temperatures are hot enough to heat the body or even to melt the silicate rock itself. So these asteroids are very different appear very different than the outer, the middle and outer asteroid in the asteroid belt. The interior, the middle part of the asteroid belt, the peak temperatures are warm enough where you could melt water ice. So this is where we think aqueous alteration could occur. And then in the outer part of the asteroid belt, and what Tahir and Emery found was that generally their checkmark shapes occur, you would expect them to be where you see hydrated minerals where you expect aqueous alteration to have occurred. Well, in the outer belt, you see the rounded water ice features, which is also predicted by the Grimm and McSween models, because you would be able to preserve water on those bodies. So this was the state of the art when I started my work. But what hasn't been possible to do with either the 0.7 micron feature or the 3-micron region is identifying the amount of hydrated minerals on an asteroid. So the 0.7 micron feature and the 3-micron feature only tell you about the presence of hydrated minerals, but not the abundance of them. So the goal of my thesis is not to just identify the presence, but to start to estimate the amount of hydration that occurred on these bodies, which may help us better understand the early solar nebular history about when water was available, how much was available, and so that's what the goal of this work is. So I've written 3 science chapters that are working towards this goal. The first one is a coordinated spectral and mineralogical study of meteorites. So we took meteorites that were characterized for bulk mineralogy in the laboratory. We used the same samples to spectrally characterize them. And then we can compare directly between the bulk mineralogy and the spectral features that we observe. So when we did this for a large suite of of meteorites, we find that in the mid-infrared, there are continuous spectral changes with degree of alteration. We define the degree of alteration as the amount of hydrated minerals in a meteorite sample. So this is just an example. This is the peak position, or the feature position on the x-axis, and the degree of alteration or amount of hydrated minerals on the y-axis. And these spectral changes give us a tool that we can use to identify or estimate the degree of alteration on asteroids remotely. The second chapter was a slightly different group of meteorites. This was a study of meteorites that are not characterized by aqueous alteration or any other parent body process, but rather preserve this amorphous iron-bearing materials, which are some of these very early nebular condensates from the early solar system. So these are interesting and unique bodies that we can, we've identified the spectral signature of the amorphous iron-bearing materials, which again gives us a tool for identifying asteroids that are rich in these really primitive materials. So here's an example. I'm showing the wavelength on the x-axis again. This is the spectra, and the normalized reflectance on the y-axis. here is one of the meteorites from the study, and we're comparing it to 93 Minerva. So the spectral similarity here indicates that Minerva probably has a large abundance of amorphous iron-bearing materials on its surface. So this body is probably one of the least processed asteroids that we know about. The last chapter that I wrote, the last science chapter, I should say, was looking at a large survey of asteroids using the tools from the first science chapter to allow us to estimate the degree of alteration and start to investigate the large-scale distribution of water in the early solar nebula. So I'm going to talk at length about this plot and the results from this chapter, and I'm going to briefly summarize the first chapter now. So in our coordinated spectral and mineralogical study, we notice these continuous spectral changes. And the changes are generally controlled by the relative abundance of olivine, which is an anhydrous mineral, and the hydrated minerals that are characterized in these extensively aqueously altered meteorites. So this is a spectrum of olivine in red, and you can see that they have different spectral features because the structure is 19 microns and 24 microns, whereas the hydrated minerals have a feature at 11.5, 16, and 21 microns. So now we're going to compare it to two meteorite spectra. So on top we have an anhydrous meteorite. This is a CB3 called Vigorano. And as you can see, it has some similarity to the olivine since it's an olivine-dominated meteorite. So it has features at around 12.7, 19.5, and 24 microns. On the bottom, this is a highly altered meteorite. So this meteorite has between 80 and 90% hydrated minerals, which we know from the bulk mineralogy. And it has spectral features similar to this terrestrial Antigorite. So we have 11.5, 16, and 21 micron features. So these are what's controlling the spectral features in the mid-infrared. So when we looked at our whole data set, we noticed that we could group the meteorites into four different categories based on their spectral characteristics. So the first, of course, is the anhydrous group, which I showed you before. So again, it's olivine dominated, 12.7, 19.5, and 24 microns. Then we have the less altered meteorites. So these meteorites are characterized by between 60 and 75% hydrated minerals, and they have features that shift to around 12.3 microns here. The 19.5 micron feature is much weaker, and you're starting to see some evidence for the 16 micron feature. The intermediately altered group has a doublet here features at 11.5 and 12.3 microns. They may have a weak 19.5 micron feature, but it kind of depends on the sample. And then finally, of course, we have the highly altered meteorites, so 11.5, 16, and 21 microns. So these are the spectral changes that we see that change continuously with degree. So we shift from 12.7 microns to 11.5 microns with the degree of alteration. We see the appearance of the 16 micron feature, and additionally, we see the disappearance of the 19 micron feature and the appearance of the 21, 22 micron. So those are the changes that we can use to estimate the degree of alteration of asteroids remotely. So we primarily use the 10 to 13 micron region, since this is an atmospheric window and it's easy to observe asteroids in this region. So moving on to the survey of asteroids, we've used three different observatories to do this work. The SOFIA Observatory here is the telescope in a plane. It flies above most of the atmospheric water and also carbon dioxide. So in addition to getting the 10 to 13 micron region, we also can get the longer wavelengths as well because we're getting above most of the carbon dioxide, which prevents us from observing in that region. We also use the infrared telescope facility on Mauna Kea, the IRTF, and the visiting instrument VAST, which is a mid-infrared spectrometer. So while IRTF is, of course, an Earth-based facility, we can only get the 10 to 13 micron region. However, Mauna Kea has some of the best skies in the world, so we can get really great data and do a large number of asteroids using this facility. And finally, we also use archive data from the Spitzer Space Telescope, which was operating in the early 2000s during its cryogenic mission. Okay, so we have 75 observations of 73 different asteroids in the survey from the three different observatories that I described. We first thermally correct these data to remove the heat component from the spectrum so we can just look at the mineralogy alone. In order to correct for any spectral contrast issues which can occur between the laboratory data and the asteroid data because of porosity or grain size, we stretch our data between 0 and 1 to remove any of those effects. So we force the minimum of the feature here to be zero, and then we normalize at 10 microns, so we can just use to compare the laboratory data to the asteroid data. So we assign, we estimate laboratory data to the stretched asteroid data. So here I'm showing 161 Athor. This is again wavelength on the x-axis, and this is emissivity now on the y-axis. And as you can see, the blue and green spectra don't really match this asteroid at all. And the red spectrum is closer, but really not a good match either. But the yellow spectrum, the less altered meteorite, seems to match best this asteroid. So we would assign this, or estimate the degree of alteration for Athor to be a less altered degree. So now I'm going to be looking at the semi-major axis here of the asteroid's orbit on the x-axis and diameter on the y-axis. This is a log scale. And the symbol and color represent the estimated degree of alteration. So the some of our objects didn't have any feature, either because they were just a truly featureless spectrum or we didn't have enough signal to noise to make to estimate a degree. The blue circles are the highly altered asteroids. Green diamonds are intermediately altered. Yellow triangles are less altered. And then anhydrous asteroids are in red. The open symbols indicate that it's a less certain assignment, so there wasn't a perfect fit, but we think it's that degree of alteration. So here I'm showing the asteroids that were known to have hydrated minerals on their surface based on the 0.7 micron feature or a checkmark 3 micron feature. So these were all objects that we previously known to be hydrated. And what we see is that there isn't a preferred degree. So there isn't, these asteroids don't have one degree of alteration. They can be essentially any degree. So what this means is that when we're observing asteroids and trying to understand them, we need to have multi-wavelength observations in order to understand both whether something is hydrated and the degree to which it's hydrated. This staying with the same axes, I'm adding now all of the asteroids that we've assigned a degree of alteration that appear to be hydrated. So these include the asteroids from the previous slide that were known to have hydrated minerals on their surfaces, and now asteroids that we've identified to be hydrated using the mid-infrared. So again, as you can see, they all appear to be altered. We don't have any anhydrous bodies. So if an asteroid has a 0.7 micron feature or 3 micron feature, it appears to be hydrated. In addition, we can identify hydrated asteroids using the mid-infrared. And again, the same result is we don't see any preferred degree of alteration for any size asteroid or any region. So the Grimm and McSween models may have suggested that we should see more hydrated minerals in the middle part of the asteroid belt, but we see all degrees of alteration mixed together throughout the whole main belt. So there isn't a preferred heliocentric distance for any degree, and there's no relationship between size and degree of alteration. So finally, I'm adding the anhydrous asteroids. So these are the ones that appear to be olivine dominated. And again, they're mixed in throughout the main belt. There's no preferred region for the anhydrous bodies. And again, we might have expected that if the Grimm and McSween models were representative of what we observed, we might have expected there to be more red symbols in the outer part of the asteroid belt where the asteroids never got hot enough to melt the water ice and interact with the anhydrous minerals to produce hydrated minerals. But we don't see that, so that's an interesting result. Furthermore, the asteroids that had rounded water ice features do not appear to be anhydrous either, which again would be predicted from both the Grimm and McSween models and what Takir and Emery observed. So here I'm comparing two of the four asteroids that we had in Antiope. As you can see, comparing it to the anhydrous olivine-dominated meteorite, there isn't a really good comparison. And in fact, the less altered meteorites are not a perfect match, but a much better fit to the data. So we've interpreted these asteroids to be aqueously altered, to have experienced aqueous alteration. So this is a totally new result. It has never been previously observed asteroids with hydrated minerals and water ice. In fact, we previously thought from the studies of comets, for example, that you couldn't have water ice and hydrated minerals at all. So this is a new result that makes us have to reevaluate our internal thermal evolution models of asteroids and our understanding of how the parent body process occurred on asteroids. The other major result from looking at the semi-major axis and the diameter and the lack of relationship between degree of alteration and location in the asteroid belt, this implies that water ice must have been a significant component of the disk at the time that these asteroids were accreting. So what that means is that the snow line must have migrated inwards around the time of this accretion. Furthermore, because the anhydrous bodies are mixed in with the hydrated asteroids, this implies that we can time the change of the snow line moving inwards. So the anhydrous asteroids and meteorites accreted slightly before the extensively aqueously altered meteorites and asteroids. So the temperatures in the disk must have been dropping at the time that the anhydrous asteroids were accreting, and then cool enough to sustain a significant amount of water ice when the aqueously altered asteroids accreted. So this timing, the anhydrous asteroids accreted approximately 2.7 million years after CAI formation, which is sort of nominal starting point of the solar system, and the extensively aqueously altered asteroids accreted between 3.6 and 4 million years after CAI formation. So the timing is pretty tight, but we think that's what this result implies. Disk models of planet formation in the early solar system have indicated that the snow line may have migrated, but this is the first evidence of that migration. In addition, we can place how far it migrated into close to 2 astronomical units, since our asteroids appear to have any degree of alteration up until even the inner part of the asteroid belt. So this is one of the big results here. I wanted to do one quick case study to wrap up my talk, looking at the near Earth object 3200 Phaeton. So Phaeton has been suggested to be a comet since it has comet-like activity. In addition, it's also the progenitor object for the Geminid meteor shower. So people originally thought that it may be a comet, but more recent studies suggest that it may be a Pallas family member based on both spectral characteristics and dynamical arguments. So we wanted to take a look in the mid-infrared to see if we could constrain this, particularly because Mike Kelly had a chance to look at comet nuclei in his 2017 paper, so we could compare directly this object with some comet nuclei observations. So this is the EMIS-17. So the shape here is, it has an apparent feature at 11.5 microns, whereas the comet has this sort of plateau in this region. So they're spectrally distinct from each other, so they're not similar. And we think this means that Phaeton is not comet-like, but rather, when we compare it to the meteorites, it appears to be a highly altered body. So this suggests that Phaeton did in fact form in the inner solar system in the asteroid belt and was later put onto its current orbit. So in addition to identifying or estimating the degree of alteration of asteroids remotely, we can also use the mid-infrared to help us understand the origin of objects in the solar system. So I just want to wrap up with my conclusions really quickly. In our coordinated spectral and mineralogical study of
questions?
Okay, good. You can
help. No. Ron.
So the great plot you had of plotting asteroid size with the center major axes,
yes,
showing the different types of, yeah, this plot. So you said there isn't, you know, you didn't find quite a gradient with alteration and stuff, but at least it seemed to me that there was some clustering in points. Is that physically?
This is currently at around 0.15 AU, so it gets very hot.
Yeah.
But it looked like you see more or less the typical spectrum.
Yes.
Can you comment on that at all?
I want to study that more. Yeah, I think it's a really interesting question, and I wonder, one of the questions that I would like to answer is, what is that close approach to the sun doing, like in terms of thermal waves, and could you be inducing secondary alteration, or what's going on that body? Is there ice in the subsurface that could continue to be reacting? I don't know. I think there's some really interesting questions. I don't know more about how I bet there are studies out there, I just am not familiar with them, to the change with that kind of intense heating for the surface, like porosity, for example. I'd be curious to learn more about that too. So I have no comment other than more studies come in.
Perfect.